Introduction to this series of Bears versus Cloud9, a game which Bears did manage to come out on top. They are currently 1-0. Maybe looking to close this out in a game two with an exhausted Cloud9. I don't know. We'll have to see. Cloud9, they're well experienced with late game. But Tsunami, somebody put it to me on Twitter. You have to remember, Bears, they've got Fada. Fada being, of course, part of the old Cloud9, is well experienced with late games.
He was born in it, molded by it, this new C9. By the time they met Fada, he was already 8 slotted. I don't smoke, but I went outside and had a cigarette break anyway after that game, because goddamn, it deserved it. There was so many things I saw in the last fight after the game ended, and it was delayed by the stream. There were so many things that I was like, I could have mentioned this, I could have mentioned that, but it was a game of inches, and Bears just, they're able to just barely squeak it out.
Yeah, they were. I mean, we had multiple scenarios where it looked like Bears were going to be the one who ended up losing that game one. There was one dire scenario where we didn't have buyback on both the Timbersaw as well as Fearless Invoker, and they still managed to hold on. They got the Aegis. They held out until their buybacks were done, and even that very last engagement, we still weren't sure how it was going to end up with Cloud9 attempting to go high ground against the Invoker. But in the end, Bears do manage to finally beat out Cloud9, close out the game, and we are now here in game number two. A game number two, which I don't know. I'm sure, like, Cloud9, they've been together long enough that I'm sure morale is still going to be quite high. They've grown together enough as a team that I don't imagine they're going to be feeling too defeated by losing an 82-minute game, but I'm sure stamina is going to play a certain cost on one of these two teams, as they do have another best of three to play after this and the grand finals where Liquid awaits them. Time.
Dire team pick.
Earth Spirit.
Radiant team pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Radiant team pick.
A huge part of the early game was, of course, Noya's Earth Spirit and his huge impact in the game. I have to say, I would expect that kind of really big Earth Spirit impact by Bears' Yapzor, because he is such an accomplished four position. But Noya easily rivaled that kind of legacy remaining with his Earth Spirit play in game number one. I think he was one of the bright sides of Cloud9 in that early game, because it wasn't exactly the prettiest early game for them, and they still managed to come out with a strong mid game, and it does seem like they are going to go for another five manny push lineup a little bit with the Rubick and Luna more pushing power this time around. Luna does finally make it into our hero pool, whereas last time I think it was banned out in the 3-4. I can't remember. Yeah.
Reserve time.
War Chief.
Radiant team ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Yeah.
Reserve time. Dire team ban.
Yeah, that is the one thing I wanted to say, is that if anybody doubted this young, I'm still going to call him a rookie. He did obviously have, Gods and I mentioned multiple times, he had multiple plays in some tier 3 NA teams. He stood in for some European teams. In fact, I was watching one of those highlight clips of one of the games recently with Yapzor. And that was a bit of a pleasure, but he's still, somewhat new to this tier 1 scene. And if anybody's doubting him, if they still had some secret doubts, well, can Furo really, he's been doing well for them, but can he really stand up to the best of teams in very high pressure scenarios? I think Furo definitely proved that he could in that game 1 with his late game Invoker plays and in such a high pressure game number 1. And Invoker is going to get banned away. Cloud9 thinking about what else they need to ban, because Bears do have a Centaur Warrunner. This is not your normal 1-2 pickup for sure. Centaur has been seeing more and more picks lately, but entering into the 1-2 pool is somewhat of a novelty for him. It does mean a nice gap closer for the whole entire team against the Luna, and I think that is something that works very well. I think Centaur actually works well against Luna as well as with Luna, because distance does seem to be one of the most important things for this carry.
Yeah, gap closer and gap creator. Luna is not really able to be very maneuverable whenever Eclipse comes out, and she would just like to have to sit still and right-click people as they panic around her, but a Centaur can immediately evacuate his entire team from an Eclipse situation. So it's, like you said, not a traditional early draft pickup, but I have confidence in Barris's drafting no matter what they do. Especially, I mean, like I'd said last game, they 2-0'd Cloud9 in the first series that they had during these qualifiers. They're the ones who sent Cloud9 to these losers bracket. So I'm sure Barris is, they know what Cloud9 likes to do, and they're very well prepared for it.
One thing that could give them some guaranteed initiation, despite the Centaur Stampede, is maybe it has to go Batrider, which normally has been, when teams are facing up against Cloud9, they'll take that as one of the bans in the second phase, but hasn't been taken away just yet. Cloud9 are actually going to shore up their team fighting potential because with this Earth Spirit Centaur opener and the way that Centaur operates, it does seem like Bears are looking to contest the Luna pushes.
5 seconds remaining. Which kind of begs the question why Cloud9 felt like banning out Dazzle, because I would be concerned with an anti-push support like Keeper of the Light. Dazzle does not really offer much in terms of drawing creep aggro off. I mean, obviously Weave is great for discouraging pushes with a whole bunch of heroes, but whenever it's the early game where no one can really take advantage of a Weave, like Centaur doesn't have a blink yet, or Earth Spirit can't confidently roll in, you need to be able to counter push just with spells, and Keeper of the Light offers that in spades. So I'm curious how C9 is going to react with the puck, actually.
Okay. I need some hard initiation. I think that was definitely needed. And we talked about a really strong holding hero that ignores Stampede. Well, Puck is one of those heroes. Thanks to Dream Coil, you have all that movement speed, but you can't go anywhere with it. Otherwise, you're just going to stun yourself. So I think that was a really good choice here from Cloud9, but it does mean they are super focused on early game. This is going to be one of the most aggressive lineups I've seen from Cloud9 yet. Knowing their reputation for 5-manning into objectives, it does feel like we are going to have a extremely fast-paced game whose end game may be determined very quickly if Bears can actually repel those pushes, defeat Cloud9 in team fights, and then all that aggression will turn to ash in Cloud9's hands as they quickly find that all their 5-manning leaves them at a gigantic experience or gold deficit. I think they played it yesterday. that Medusa Drow Ranger combination, I believe in the middle of major, Liquid pulled that out, and then with the offlane Puck, that's been an old standard as well. So it's looking kind of similar, right? It's looking very similar to that lineup. Some you've got Rubick just like last time, Undying as opposed to Ogre, a little bit more team fight as opposed to lane presence, and they could move this Puck into the offlane and then end up picking a some sort of scaling mid. No, not a drum mid. Maybe, like, I'm not sure if Dusa Luna really works, but I'm thinking some sort of scaling mid, similar to the SF, or in this case, maybe because a Lifestealer's out in the pool, maybe they can go more early game and focus on, like, Razor or Viper, which are also Baby Knight heroes.
Ten seconds remaining. Dire team ban.
Queen of Pain banned by Cloud9. Again, the potential vehicle for a Lifestealer when he doesn't have that early Blink Dagger. Remaining. Gives you some options to work around. I think it also would have been a nice 1v1 matchup that Firo or Fada, I'm not sure which one's actually going to be playing the mid laner just yet. Yeah, sure enough, Bears very smartly ban away the Viper. There is still the Razor out there, which we saw the way that counters the Lifestealer pretty nicely. How do you feel about the Razor mid, though? Obviously, the Bears pick is going to play some impact.
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Shadow Fiend.
Radiant team pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
DK wouldn't be bad, right? High armor versus Lifestealer. Tanky hero doesn't do that badly against SF, but he has been out of the meta for quite some time. Cloud9 are going to choose for a much squishier option, but it is still a hero that works very well against Lifestealer and matches well against the SF.
Ten seconds remaining.
You think they're probably going to need a support in mid lane? Just like, remaining. You know, how we've seen before with the SF. He always gets that babysitting of the Earth Spirit. Think they're going to need somebody to make sure TA's early game does go rather well and is encountered by the Earth Spirit so we can have that strong mid game.
It depends how self-sufficient this Hestajo Puck is, because ideally I would like the Undying to be able to spend a lot of time mid making sure that TA is able to make sure that SF doesn't get a fair amount of souls, and then once you have Refraction and Psyblades up and running, then the lane is pretty much on autopilot. But at the same time, I don't want this Puck to be useless, so if Noya needs to stick around in the Puck's lane to make sure that Puck doesn't get immediately zoned out at level 1, it's a tough call which you would prefer.
Noya does manage to keep his smoke intact against Adam, so we may have an idea that there is some sort of Observer Ward placed in the leaning area for Hestajo, and he does keep his counter ward, which is currently blocking out the easy camp spawn. He does keep that hidden for now. This is going to be a very different scenario, though, from last time we saw the Hestajo Puck. Last time around, he had the Drow Ranger, which is a big up in physical damage and allows you to be able to beat back the support that is trying to zone you out. But here, without that extra aura in lane, Hestajo is going to have a bit harder time. But he is against a Lifestealer and Coddle. That isn't going to be the most treacherous of lanes. In fact, with Noya, they are going to try and take this bounty rune. Decay goes out. They already get a big blast, though. And Noya's dropping lower and lower. He can't really commit to the Bounty Rune. Fawn is still going to be able to pick it up. And it looks like Noya just gave up First Blood as well as the Bounty.
Will use it?
Yapsar has a roll in 2 seconds. The creeps aren't going to spawn for another 15. He needs to dodge this roll. Can't do it. Yapsar nails him. First Blood goes to him.
Okay, well, I guess that means that Rubick needs to go and police the mid lane. He used telekinesis. What did Rubick use telekinesis on? I hope it wasn't the Ancients, because that's not a thing anymore. Ancients aren't even up yet. I don't know what I'm talking about.
I don't know. Maybe he, maybe he grabbed the SF.
Rolling in on mid, Baby Knight taking damage.
Baby Knight eats one of his Ironwood branches with the shared tango, trying to maintain a healthy status in this lane. Hestijo, he'll be dealing with 1v2 for now, and it's going to be Noya zoning out Ferev in the bottom lane since Rubick, I guess, can't really do it alone. Noya is a little bit better suited to those actions.
Alone or at all. I'm not sure if Ryze is even interested in leaving this mid lane at any point, because this is an intense duel going on between all four heroes over here.
Hestijo is going to get himself a full wave here. Looks like Adam tried to get the counter ward out to open up that easy camp, allow him to be able to keep the lane back and zone Hestijo a little bit better, but it's not going to happen. Hestijo will actually have himself a pretty good lane, it seems like. That easy camp pull, I think, is very important to make sure that Puck does have a good lane. As we talked about, the Drow Ranger aura does mean a lot for being able to deal with zoning supports. So he's going to get the levels necessary to beat back the Caudle, and the Lifestealer's not much of a threat.
Yeah, and actually Puck is very well suited because of phase shift, so you sealed it telegraphed pretty easily. Rolling on mid, not going to catch anyone. So, I mean, all things considered, Puck is a very good offlaner in this situation. Most situations, I don't think so, but right now, Hestijo's going to go pretty much unimpeded, which I don't know what Caudle's responsibility is, because he's not going to be able to zone out the Puck, and mid lane is all booked up, so what's the plan?
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't try and go. I thought he was going to go for early mana leak and try and make it so Hestijo, you know, they mana leak, they kind of charge at him, and Fada forces Hestijo to move around and maybe use those orbs. And once he's out of those orbs, then Lifestealer finally can have an impact. But if they don't take away that mana, then Hestijo is going to be a permanent fixture in this lane, always in their face. Maybe that is a large part because of the shrine and that recovery mechanism that is available. Maybe the mana leak just isn't as effective against these offlaners anymore.
That's true, especially because Lifestealer, I mean, you need to walk at people like this, and then Hestijo can just take himself out and head on to the shrine. Which, actually, Yapsar might meet him? No.
Hestijo looking for that full heal. Ryze sees Yapsar, again trying to get on that raiding cliff that we saw so many times Cloud9 using last time around to get the Earth Spirit Rollins. Baby Knight's doing quite well for himself, 14-5 compared to the 9-5 of Firo, but this is to be expected. Firo actually going to drop really well with the telekinesis. They don't have a meld strike, but the right click comes out from Ryze, a fairy fire, and now a healing salve from Firo will bump him back up to full HP. Adam may be caught though. Joe's going to be able to take him out with that waning rift. Well played. The offlane Puck finding the first kill of our true laning phase, since Noya did give up the first blood.
Wow, okay, that's really important. I can't believe that Puck offlane is being able to prove to be so dominant against this lane. And I mean, that kill, almost kill mid, could have been really big. And thankfully, Yapsar is kind of in the vicinity. Didn't really help against that gank attempt, but his silence?
The silence and the kick to stall up the damage on Firo, but he is being constantly threatened. Oh, 8 HP is all that's left. He heads back to the shrine and will receive almost a full heal off of that one. Actually does this early on to the game, but they are really taking it to Firo, and I think they did try and put a lot of pressure on him last time as well on the Invoker. He does seem to be one of the big keys of success for Bears. Has Hestijo, nice dodge on that one. Will manage to get the... Nice silence. Yapsar managed to catch Hestijo. Hestijo will now die. A big pickup as Fada now will pick up his level 5 against that level 5 Puck. Adam not actually blocked in by Noya there. I thought he was going to be, but they may still be able to run him down with the extra movement speed of Ace. He does close that gap and get the auto attack required. 2-2 now.
You see, I did want the Keeper to go to the bot lane because he wasn't really doing much in the top lane, but I wanted him to go with the Centaur. I didn't want to just fend for himself because Centaur plus Caudle can be pretty irritating, especially for just a Luna. But Ace has gone unimpeded this lane, and like Puck is doing fine, TA is doing fine. C9 are very pleased with how the laning phase is going right now.
Yeah, certainly. Dire scan on the shrine here. I'm not sure what they're expecting. Maybe Ryze. Yeah, we're probably expecting Ryze to wrap around since he's no longer in the mid lane. They have the mid vision from this fresh ward to see that he's not sticking around. So do you have an idea about this aggressive maneuver?
Top lane has to Joe dueling again with Fada.
Gonna be able to get out just fine, but very low HP and no shrine to heal him back up.
That silence that Yasuo used on Puck is gonna be a problem all game long, and so it's kind of it's a weird situation as a Puck because you put out the illusory orb, you want to go as far as possible, but at the same time, the Earth Spirit knows you want to go as far as possible and is gonna hold on to that silence until you're like, okay, it's about 1,000 units away. I'm jaunty now. Oh wait, I can't. So, I don't really know how you itemize this Puck this game. Like, do you go for the Yules just to take that off, or do you want aggressive, go for the Blink Dagger? And given his start, kill onto Yapzor, Eclipse used.
Nice pickup. Tombstone will be left out there. It's the kind of aggressive plays that they want to be able to find the kills and then turn that into a tier 1 tower. It's not going to be possible though with Adam sitting so far back. He's sitting on the far right hand side and always is blasting away. So that early advantage that is usually found by Luna is being countered by the Caudle currently. Hester Joe did have to jump to his orb pretty far out there. Yapzor is going to be able to get ahead of him, manage to land the kick, silence, and Yapzor claims another kill. The Earth Spirit, it seems, is going to be just as effective in the early game as Noya's was last game.
Is it really that big of a concern for the Luna to get a tier 1 that early on this game, though? Because it's not really... Like Caudle's going to be here, always. You take the tower or you don't, like, Caudle's still going to be able to hang around in this lane. Right now, Adam is too scared to get an experience range, whereas if the tower goes down, then maybe he feels a little bit more confident.
Yeah, probably not. I think it's just one of like the small advantages that Luna and like Draw Ranger lineups True. Give you is just like that early bit of gold that sometimes help out your mid or offlaner, especially your offlaner to get that earlier item. It does look like Hester Joe is going to be going for treads. Probably thinking about that he's going to be sticking in lane a lot more than your normal offlaners and is willing to go more of a laning phase item build, delaying that Blink Dagger slightly.
If he does want to rotate, it's going to be just like a TP rotation, either to react to a fight or to react to C9 being like, all right, we're five manning, come and join us because you have Dream Coil. So until C9 starts making moves, which I don't really see happening anytime soon, like you said, Luna's not being too antsy about taking this tier one and everyone's getting experience. Rubick is level 4 just roaming around pretty much.
That is something with these kind of we wanted to see a tankier mid, right? A lane dominating mid, kind of like Viper, to give Cloud9 a bit of sustain. Cloud9 are very squishy because of their choice of the Templar Assassin. If the right kind of initiation comes through from Bears, they blow up this whole entire lineup. So I do like the fact that they're not trying to be overly aggressive like we've seen from C9 before. And when it comes to taking objectives, I think you need to focus on making sure you have your early game farm first. That way you have a very big impact around 15 minutes. An attempt at a smoke from Hester Joe and Ryze gets spotted though by Ferev. Bottom lane, Noya's going to be caught here. As he tried to lane out, gets blasted down. Bears make their first aggressive infest maneuver.
Yeah, I like how Ferev, that was incredibly fortuitous positioning to be able to pop that smoke because, man, that kill on Shadow Fiend would have been huge. But in the meantime, Centaur is getting closer and closer to Blink. And like we said, it's a very squishy C9 team. Blink initiation with a stampede to help the rest of Bears come in could spell some very early five-man team fights.
Here come the blasts. Baby Knight will be one of the better heroes to deal with that Illumina blast, pushing them back. while Luna is probably one of the worst heroes just because of her very low range. She's trying to finish up the Helm of Dominating right now. Bears are playing very reminiscent of their debut game that we saw from them with the Fiora SF. He's been playing, because of a bad matchup, been playing jungle most of the time. Knows that his farm is not going to be that much less because of how the neutrals are working out for him. So he's been playing very conservatively, and Bears are basically just buying time for Firo with a little bit of aggressive action from Lifestealer, and then the Caudal pushing back these tower pushes. Cloud9 aren't really doing much but farming, and that's fine by Firo.
Yep, so it finds Ace, but not going to be able to do anything. So they are making room for Firo, but so what is, so Firo has a Glove of Haste. Is he going to go for Midas, or is that just for treads? Like, what is the item progression for a Shadow Fiend this game?
Oh, Ace. Bot. He is going to be feeling the big-time nukes. The Illuminate Blast does land. Multiple TPs are coming in. They'll finish off Ace, yes, but now they're going to be caught by the Drain Coil and pass to Joe. Fada turns, attempts to fight, does not have the Rage to be able to jump out of this coil, but he's having to deal with the Tombstone Zombies the whole entire time. Rage coming back up in 1 second time. Can he just Rage TP away? Looks like he will be good and try and get some extra damage, but Fada doesn't even bother to use that magic immunity. So big-time kill, taking out Ace, and treating away the Yapzor Earth Spirit. Well worth it in the minds of Bears.
They trade Yapzor Earth Spirit, and he used like literally every single one of his stones in the bank for that. They were hoping to get more kills after they got Dream Coiled, which is a bit overzealous. Sure, Magnetize is a great spell and all, but Fada isn't really able to stick around in a fight for that long, especially if the Centaur isn't around. And Stampede was used at some point, and I'm not sure on what, but yeah, I mean, this is just the early aggression that Bears needs to pull, because right now C9, they can only play reactionary right now, as all their team is trying to get the items necessary.
It might have been when they first jumped in. It's a little bit of extra burst damage, right? And they needed to be able to kill Ace before Rage was down and Eclipse is used. So, as a result, they will take that Tier 1 tower. That will mean Ferev is about to pick up that Blink Dagger. He's just 200 gold away.
See, if they want to defend this mid Tier 1, Hero comes in. But right now, it's just Ryze and Baby Knight. We'll see if Hestijo... Wherever Hestijo goes is where I'm most interested in, because he's there to either stop fights or start fights. And last in the bot push, oh nice, roll in.
Nice silence from Yapzor preemptively as he rolls in, manages to stop Hestijo from phase shifting. And Fada easily cleans up the kill.
Well, he did start that fight, so I'm still right. Just wasn't the fight that he wanted.
This is going to be really fast Desolator with the way they're successfully hitting these ganks. They're going to pop back in with the Infest. Doesn't quite land the boulder, but it will be okay with the stun. They'll still manage to get that kill, but Fada's in pretty deep.
He has Rage TP.
Rage TP out. Nothing to stop there. Yapzor is looking for a rollout himself or a TP. Ryze gets the telekinesis, and they will get that kill. Support for support, but it's space for Firo.
Yapzor is burning through these rocks. He would have been liked to be able to get out of that. Nice double edge on to Hestijo, but the first raise misses.
Hero's just going to straight TP out. Ryze won't be there in time to be able to stop it. Telekinesis still on cooldown anyway, but they are running Cloud9 around the map. You could see Adam is about to take a Tier 1 tower in the top lane, so C9 just barreled through mid, trying to take that bigger objective mid-Tier 1 tower. All important for early map control.
They have Tombstone, but Lifestealer's pretty good at dealing with Tombstone, so we'll see how Fada, he's holding on to Rage, and he might just use it, yeah.
Yep. Throws it kind of defensively, but Fada, he jumps forward. Tombstone gold will go to Firo, that's 175. Not something you can just give up whenever you want to. That is a bit dangerous.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of economy and in terms of counter push, because now they don't have Tombstone to discourage Bears from fighting. There's a Stampede up. Well, pretty much all ultimates of Bears are up if they want to push this, and they have the Dragonlance completed on Firo. I'm surprised they're not pushing more aggressively for this. Maybe
this
if they get
a
pick
big
first.
Pick off. The refraction is going to wear out here with the silence now on Baby Knight. Can't meld, can't refract again. They try and finish him off the Stampede, but now the turnaround. Baby Knight, he's drop low enough that Firo can finish him off with the raises. The Eclipse was not dealing enough damage. Looks like it was too split. Rev managed to tank most of it. Nice kick from Yapzor. A follow-up silence. Hester Joe's trying to stay ahead of Fada. Face shift for a second, but can't get the orb out. Now Ryze's going to be caught. Yapzor rolls in, managed to catch him. And this is why the Yapzor Earth Spirit is so feared. Almost every single one of these deaths on the side of Cloud9 has been because of Yapzor's presence. He's 2-3-8, so it has been every single death.
It's not even him being, like, luckily at the right place at the right time. Yapzor is creating these situations for himself. They got the, I guess, Blink Dagger reveal Centaur. Oh, not showing his own Blink Dagger on mid.
Hero, let's lose the ultimate. That's going to eat through the refraction. The refraction attack damage instances are still out, though, there. And Fearow almost drops because of it. Another great kick from Yapzor does prevent Fearow from dying as a Lucent Beam was ready to come out from Ace.
In an alternate universe, Yapzor actually gets a Psyblade and a Glaive target to kill Fearow, but he gets out just fine. Yeah, I mean, Yapzor, his positioning is impeccable this game, and Centaur showed off his Blink Dagger to get that kill on TA. Thankfully, I guess TA must have bought out right before she died and got her own Blink Dagger completed, so now things are going to pick up on both teams because they want to take advantage of this first early pickup, and I think that C9 is going to be using their Blink Dagger more defensively, but it depends on the kind of openings that they find. Maybe Puck wants to play a little bit more aggressively, which Hester Joe had a great lead early on, but since then has kind of dwindled.
Yeah, it certainly has. He's almost 2k gold behind the Centaur. Rev, he's got his Blink Dagger and is going to be working towards that Hooded Defiance and Pipe. If you can get her early enough, that will mitigate the big teamfight advantage that Cloud9 is supposed to have with the Luna and that Eclipse.
Man. I realize now that Ferev has a cloak, but actually, I think a Lucent Beam could have maybe killed the Centaur while jungling, but in 7.02, Luna does not get 1800 night vision just right off the bat. Right now, it's just sitting with bonus 250 instead of bonus 1000, so didn't see this.
Nice double stomp with a double kick coming in as well. Doesn't look like it hit Baby Knight, so he's able to blink backwards, but Ace is already gone as well as the Tombstone. A Dream Call comes out. He may have to jump backwards into the back lines of Bears here and probably still get caught out as he doesn't have a blink to be able to get away. Baby Knight trying to punish Fada there, but it looks like the tier 1 tower, the first one at mid, will be taken by Bears, thanks in large part to Ferev's initiation.
So wait, did Puck like jaunt into the orb that was going into the dire half of the map? Because I saw the Dream Coil and Puck was on the Radiant side of the river, and then Puck died on the dire side of the river.
Yeah, it's because he was open wounded by Fada.
Okay.
So he was like, oh crap, I can't run away. I don't have Blink Dagger. So you just kind of have to jaunt to the orb and hope for the best. Roshan is going to be taken down before C9 can get here.
So fast. Yeah, Desolator completed, three levels in Presence of the Dark Lord. That is such a quick Roche at this stage, and I don't really know if they're going to want to 5-0 with this, or they're just going to be like, alright, Fearow, we don't need to really worry about you too much. You have a Blink Dagger completed on your SF. Just go farm, be merry, and we'll take care of the rest of the map.
Yeah, C9, I think they had the right idea in the beginning, but maybe they just played a bit too defensively, a little bit too slow, because then it just allowed the Lifestealer Earth Spirit to find all these openings, and
they kind
their
of
farm is dwindling.
Themselves into this corner, though, because like they have squishy heroes, and TA completed first item Blink Dagger. That's like a real double down on the fact that like I'm not going to be able to show up to any 5-on-5 fights. I may be able to find a pickoff on like a Keeper or... Well, actually, pretty much just Keeper, because even Earth Spirit can roll out just fine. So, I am still not a fan of this fifth pick TA. We'll see if it nets them anything. At least maybe 9 is closing in on a Desolator, but this is way after the Lifestealer completes their Desolator, so even the early Roche advantage that TAs usually get isn't going to be a thing.
Ryze being a good guy, trying to open up farm for the Puck with a Fate Bolt. Will be Noya caught. But it looks like Ace is going to get away, unless with the Blink Dagger of Fearow. No. They don't have anything to catch Ace. So maybe a tier 2, a quick push. Surprising Cloud9. Fearow's actually going to TP back. They really want to keep this mid tower alive.
Gets into deny range, so maybe they'll let it go. Yeah, but still, it's hurting the economy of Cloud9, and they need every little bit that they can get. They are almost 10,000 net worth down right now at 20 minutes into the game. They don't have a single tower. They didn't actually finish denying that mid tower, so yeah, they have no towers taken yet.
Hester Joe has his blink dagger. They got to do something magical with this initiation now. They got to TP up Fada here at the top lane, and that's not too bad. He does reveal the blink dagger, but I don't think it's... He was trying to hide it in the first place. I was going to say maybe he just TPs into like the shrine or the mid-tier 2 and they try and get aggressive on Bears while Fada's at top lane. They need to try and take advantage of this time to get the blink, as well as Bears being a little bit split up. But it looks like Ryze is going to be the one caught here. Stampede going to run him over. Navy Knight watches as his support dies. They're going to get the Dream Coil out onto just one there. They do have the Eclipse, but Ferez able to take it really well with the Hood of Defiance. Now all the damage, it's gone. Hero's lined up for the ultimate with a sick combination from the Absor, setting up all of that with his stun. Bears trample quite literally with the Stampede over Cloud9. They take all five heroes and do not even drop the Centaur.
It's almost as if Dreamcoil and the Centaur won the fight for Bears, because if Puck manages to get no one, then you're like, all right, let's just back off. We did not get the initiation we wanted. Luna hops in, is like, all right, you got someone? Yeah, sure, I'll toss an Eclipse on them. Ferev doesn't care. He has the full Hood completed, doesn't even die. Aegis isn't even, like, scratched. Hero just used the most... Or like the what a godlike requiem at freaking 20 minutes into the game. Granted, he does have a blink dagger to help out, but still just tears Cloud9 apart.
You know, I was supposed to be doling out a really good compliment to Noya and his Earth Spirit. And honestly, it was a very respectable Earth Spirit player. He had a huge hit impact laning phase, but I'm not
good?
Sure. Yeah,
was
I'm not sure if it's
good?
This good. Yapdor's gonna be able to get a double kill. Silence. Cloud9 try and jump forward here, seeing Bears a little bit low on HP and SF at the top lane, but they just can't do it. Not without Eclipse. Now the bounce back. Ace is running out of mana. The mana leak wears out, but now he's hit by the stomp. Heads to Joe, tries to stop all this with a jump in silent Dream Coil, but it's still not enough. The Illumina Blast finishes him off. Baby Knight in the back lines does finally get a kill for Cloud9. It's going to be the Centaur, but now he's left in no man's land against the SF and the Earth Spirit. 6-21, they trade 1-3, and Bears pushing high ground by 22 minutes.
Bears are angry. They were like, I can't believe you made me sit through that 80-minute game one. I can't believe that you just... This is grisly, is what it is. Bears are not relenting at any point. Freaking Furo is level 18 right now. I don't really know what the late game, mid game, any minute after 25 game plan is for C9.
Melee racks gone. Cloud9. Not sure what to do at this point. Most of their heroes
on Coddle.
Yeah. So there goes all map control. Like, you've already lost all your outer towers, but also you're gonna lose all your outer wards, most likely.
Gonna lose shrines as well.
Yeah, tier 3 down, opens that up. First one's going to be that Roshan Shrine. Honestly, Cloud9, they need some miraculous 5-man smokes and some pickoffs.
Pickoffs, yes, but TA only finds a Centaur with this shiny new Desolator. Meanwhile, Fada gets a kill on a Rubick.
I need the Dream Coil to slow down Ferev. He turns around, threatens something, but he doesn't actually have Host Stomp, so he will end up dying here. That's a big pick. That kill is worth... 500? No, that's the lifestealer one. Show me an updated fight recap. Come on now. There we go.
You can just look at the bottom right, and can't you?
No, I want to see how much gold he lost and stuff like that. So it's like 1,000 gold swing. You know, it's like 1,100 gold swing, just that pickoff.
All right, meanwhile, Fod is pushing the other top three uncontested, so that's not good.
Pull the SF to the fight as well.
I thought there's no way. There's no way I'm going to get this tower completely uncontested. Something is wrong. I'm backing off.
And it's Firo who's going to finish it off for him. An Orchid on the Lifestealer. Butterfly already for Firo. Jesus, it's just looking worse and worse. Axe is being built by Ferev after the pipe. He's also got a gem. So if they can give that one over to Adam, they'll have perfect vision of any wards being placed by Cloud9. There's not too many. There's just this one ward that's sitting outside the base right now.
But now it's daytime. The glorious day where Coddle can run free. They don't have... Oh, never mind. They have a gem. Centaur bought it for Adam. And now all the energy that he spent... Oh, bye-bye, Illusion. It's okay. They can afford to do that. They can afford to do that like 10 times over and still win this game.
They certainly can. They've taken the other shrine. Ags is also being built on Yapzor. Apparently Yapzor really wants to show Noya how you use it.
Yeah, I would like to see it. Hopefully we can complete it before the game ends, as now there's a Blink Dagger with most people would expect the Centaur to be the vehicle, but no, it's going to be...
Oh, nice Blink Spirit. Silence. Hester Joe's caught. He goes down. Frev does receive the telekinesis. He tries to go in. Ace just moves forward with the Eclipse. They've already taken out the Coddle. He's trying to get these bounces on Yapzor. Does manage to block his roll out, get the physical damage to finish him off, but Fada will clean up that other kill. They do turn this fight pretty decently. They've killed Frev. Now Baby Knight. He does have the refraction charges now that the damage over time is gone, but SF is here. He has to blink out. Nice timing there from Baby Knight. Looks like they'll get away. Trade free. 3 for 3. And they lost two of their cores, but I still think that's to the advantage of Cloud9, considering the gigantic lead by Bears.
Oh, hell yeah. Anything that they can get is an advantage. I can't believe that they were able to even get those three to begin with. Granted, SF wasn't there, and Lifesteer was just kind of running around trying to claw away at the Luna. Immediately, Coddle got blown up, and so once he got blown up, not only did it turn to night with the Luna Eclipse, but there was no vision to see the rest of C9, so... They get in a pretty handsome fight, but unfortunately they don't kill any of Bears' cores, and in fact, Lifestealer just, like, made money. He basically just sacrificed his supports to the gods of Dota and said, okay, thank you, please give me more income so I can complete this assault caress.
Oh, shit, they picked up the gem! Yeah. Like, I was about to say, because Centaur died, so I'm surprised they don't have that one on them right now, because they have to know there's a lot of aggressive wards out from Bears.
I thought the Shadow Fiend saw it. I saw it pinged out someone. Oh, Frev pinged it. So he pinged out his own gem. I don't know why they're keeping it on the courier, but I guess they don't really feel like venturing anywhere past the stairs.
Well, they're going to give up a Roshan as a result. Another Aegis. This one for Firo, who is building a Satanic alongside that Butterfly. Fada has an Assault Cuirass, and that Aghanim Scepter is closing in for Ferev. And then the Stampede gets really useful against the Dream Coil, because the Dream Coil is usually when you're going to be outputting a lot of damage, so then the damage reduction of Stampede rather than the movement speed becomes the more effective part of that ultimate.
Exactly, and Eclipse will probably lose all of its efficacy between Pipe and that Ag, but I mean, they don't need to wait for it. Tier 3 is down.
They do see Ace on the side. They're going to be able to get the Hoof Stomp, an Orchid as well. They take him down, Rise down to half health after just one shot from Firo. Here comes that second shot. A third one is needed. Rise, oh, the Shrine, not going to be good enough to save him. Firo 1v2 in the back lines. It looks like Baby Knight's trying to get things done, but there's too many heroes back there. He ends up dying. No buyback there. Cloud9, beyond godlike triple kill for Firo. I have to say, Cloud9, like, that the game won. It was awesome.
And, damn good game.
Yeah, and the fact that Cloud9, they also had that series against Secret as well. Very respectable. I think that you could see the growth that Cloud9 is having, but this game too really did show that Bears are on another level. And that's somewhat to be expected with so many star players on their team.